As you know, we have their grandson, Jordan. Stephanie is our youth directors. And today, they have another grandson with his lovely wife, Nicole, Nathanael, Nicole. And he's sensing, he's got the call to go into missions and do some ministry. And he has come here today to share for a few minutes with us about that ministry. And it's good to see our younger generation receiving the call of the Lord. Amen? Amen. And I know that feeling with Alicia being over in Saipan doing what she's doing for the Lord. So I want Nicole and Nathanael and Nicole to come this time, Sommers. And they're going to come and share with you what's on their heart and what God is doing. Would you come this time? Bless the Lord.
Perfect. All right, everyone can hear us now. We'll come up here. My name's Nathanael, and this is my wife, Nicole, as you said, and Larry and Clarinette Wilson are our grandparents, and we have been blessed with that. But this church, I want to thank you guys, first and foremost. I've been in and out of this church, you know, throughout my whole childhood and everything. You guys have been such an influence on our whole family, not just me, but everything that you guys have done for us, and I want to just thank you for that right now. And a lot of the influence from this church is a part of why I ended up going into missions, and just the atmosphere of love and the way that God worked through you guys. So thank you so much for that. Our story starts back in college. We both went to Indiana Wesleyan over in Marion. And I actually went in not thinking I would, you know, be a missionary or go into ministry at all, actually. I went in thinking I was going to be a college professor someday. I wanted to teach history. It was kind of my passion. Still have a passion for it, but God kind of, you know, had better plans for me. So between my freshman and sophomore year, I was working at a bunch of different camps, and I was helping Indiana Wesleyan send groups out to youth camps so that we could minister to them and share the love of Christ. And it was during those camps I found myself oftentimes being kind of the sports guy at these camps, because I was athletic and I loved doing stuff with the children. And through those camps, God finally hit me and was like, you know what, this is what you should do with your life. You have a calling to go into the mission field and to serve people through the avenue of sport. And at first, you know, I didn't really know how to take in stuff. So one week I was in Iowa and I had this dream. And in the dream, my pastor at New Life Assembly of God, he prayed over me and said, you know what, you're going to go into the ministry. And so I called my parents and I was like, you'll never believe the dream I just had. It was the weirdest thing. And I had been having these feelings that, you know, I should go into ministry and stuff. And then I had this dream. And my mom just started laughing. And she was like, you know what, that actually happened when you were a kid. He prayed over you and prophesied that you're going to go into the ministry. So we've just been waiting for it to happen. So, you know, God has a way to finally get you, you know, where you need to be, even if you don't expect it. So after that, I decided to change my major. So I became a sports ministry major. I knew that sports was the avenue that he was calling me to go in. My passion was sport. Soccer is something that I love. And I know for a fact, you know, and so you guys, like, sport is a way that we can reach the young people in this community, in this country, around the world, because it is so important to people. And it's how they fill that void that we have, that God fills. But a lot of people try to fill it with sport. And if we can bridge that gap by something they understand, then we can really reach people. So I continued that journey then through college, and then my senior year, I still didn't know if I wanted to be a missionary or not. Senior year, I met somebody from World Gospel Mission over in Marion, and they really guided me through the process. They became a friend to me, and it was at that time that God really said, you know what, I want you to become a missionary. And at the time, I thought that meant going overseas, and we're ending up going to McAllen, Texas, but my wife is going to tell you more about that story.
So for me, unlike Nathanael, I had absolutely no idea what I wanted to do when I went to college. I was just going to Indiana Wesleyan and, you know, just taking a bunch of the general education classes. But a part of being undeclared, I had to take a class called Life Calling. That class really made me look at who I was and who I wanted to be and what my passions were. And through that, we had to look at lots of different majors, and I did my research and I came across one called International Community and Development. Now, most people have absolutely no idea what that means, and well, it can mean just about anything. But for me, that meant I wanted to work with diverse groups of people in some way, helping them doing compassionate ministries. With that, I had to do an internship outside of the country, and I ended up going to Romania and doing my internship there, and that really just opened my heart up to working with diverse people and just really reaching out, especially to youth and children. And through that, you know, I ended up meeting Nathanael at school playing soccer. So I too also have a passion for sports. It was kind of going. He kind of took a while to warm up to the idea of me. But when it came to, he asked me to marry him, and I was so willing to go into the mission field with him, as he had already started that process. Originally, we were going to go to Spain and work with immigrants there. However, you know, God has a sense of humor, and he likes to do whatever he wants. And so he then closed that field for us, and he then opened up a new field, and that was McAllen, Texas. And in Texas, there is, since it's right on the border with Mexico, there's just a lot of gang presence, and there's just a lot of brokenness, and a lot of immigrants. And so those are the people that we're going to be working with. So with that, in McAllen, the ministry there has been there for roughly around 100 years with World Gospel Mission. But for the longest time, it was just a school called Taylor Christian School. That school currently enrolls around 40 to 50 people, children ages pre-K through 12th grade. There is also Taylor Community Center, and that is one of the newer ministries, and it's growing, but it's a work in process.
Yeah, so we're actually going to be working with the community center for the most part. The Christian school there is pretty established. They've got teachers. A lot of the missionaries that are there, they are teachers at the school. So what they do is they raise support so that they can work there for free. And that lowers the tuition cost for the community so they can actually attend the school. Because a lot of them, I mean, it's an immigrant community. They do not have, you know, wealth or any really means to be able to survive and stuff. So the school's established. They kind of do their thing. You know, we'll help a little bit. Matter of fact, I think the very first semester next year we'll probably be the PE teachers. But, you know, we'll just kind of do what we need to, whether it's maintenance, you know, all that. But the community center is where we're really coming in and taking part of. They have one couple and a single lady right now who are running the entire community center, trying to do every single program. And anyone involved in ministry knows that doing it by yourself is pretty much impossible. So they are stretched very thin. They have a lot of different programs that they're already doing. One of their biggest ones is soccer. Obviously down in Texas with the Mexican immigrants coming up, soccer is huge in Central America. And it's something that they love, something that they want to do. So it's the best way to bring people in. So they have youth soccer programs right now for kids, and they do club soccer, all kinds of things. And through that, they meet the families. When we went and visited last fall, we were able to go and kind of experience a little bit of that. and you had all the kids playing out in the field and stuff, but then you had just a multitude of family, because not just mom and dad come out. It's mom and dad, brother, sister, grandparents, great aunts, great uncles. It's everybody. They come out, they see, they talk to people. We get to just kind of mingle, talk with them. And it's a wonderful chance to be able to meet the people in the community and bring them into the community center. So there's a whole bunch of different soccer outreaches. Then there's also a Bible club where the kids come in, they come in to play soccer, and then we form relationships with them, and then they continue to interact with us by coming to our Bible club and a discipleship courses. And it's that time where we really start to see changes in lives. So that's our whole goal. In everything that we do, we bring them in through sport, and then through that, you start seeing changes in their lives through Jesus Christ, which is an amazing experience. It's amazing to see. Another thing that we have is family night. Once a month, they come in. The whole families are able to come into the gymnasium and play volleyball, do games, do all different kinds of things, and it keeps the community involved. Since the center only has, you know, very few people running it right now, this is all that they can really do. But we're going to come in, and we're going to take all these programs that they have and expand them, because they do family night once a month, because that's all they can do. We want to come in and be able to make it more accessible, be able to make a weekly event type of thing that they can do, so that the community has some place that they can go. The youth have a place to go that keeps them away from the streets, away from the gang life, from all the other things in life that, you know, come thrown at you, especially immigrants, where if they don't have work, they're just kind of hanging out, you know. And, you know, if you're unemployed, it's a little boring, right? And it's hard to be able to know what to do with yourself, and that's when trouble starts happening, especially with the youth. So that's our goal, is to be able to give them a place to be able to come. We also have the Sparrow's Nest, which is a clothing pantry. As we said, they don't have a lot of wealth. They don't have the means to support themselves oftentimes. So this gives us a chance to be able to clothe people. And it's another way to be able to bring them in to the community center, to the school, and then into the church after that. Our vision is, like I mentioned, we want to be able to expand all the ministries. We want to be able to really give them a place to be at. Also to be able to form relationships with the youth. Our main goal is going to be working with the young adults in the community. It's an age group that, even here, you know, it's so hard to reach young adults, whether it's high school level or going up into early 20s. It's just a very difficult thing for any church, any community, anywhere in the world. So that's what we want to do. We're that age, you know, we're going to be able to connect with these guys, and I'm going to be starting a lot of open gyms, a lot of opportunities for people just to come in, just to play sports, to form those relationships, because that's when you really start connecting with people, is when you get that friendship first, you know. A lot of people in our culture do not want to have Jesus just thrown at them, right? It immediately turns them off, because there's a lot of bad connotations, unfortunately, with Christianity. But if you go in with the intent to really change their lives for the better, not even thinking about religion, you just come in, you know what, I'm going to be a friend to you, I'm going to love you for who you are. And that right there alone is something that they've never experienced before, because love is dead in our culture, unfortunately. So we're going to love them, we're going to give them opportunities to be able to hang out, be able to have a safe place, a safe environment. And then our vision, you know, be able to connect with different community centers in the area. McAllen is one of the fastest growing cities in the United States right now, largely because of the immigrant population. So we want to be able to connect with a bunch of churches, local community centers, be able to really get this going, and be able to use our talents to be able to get this off the ground and give it everything it needs. There's a lot of ongoing needs right now for the center and the school. It's been around for almost 100 years, so the building's almost 100 years old. It's pretty old. There's a lot of stuff that just needs to be remodeled. We have a lot of teams come down during the winter, because we call them winter Texans. They come, they stay, and it's really nice down there. So if you ever get tired of the cold up here, just come on down and visit us, and we'll put you up. We've got a whole place where you can stay at, work and everything. It's a wonderful experience. We have a lot of people who come and do it every single year. So we have a whole lot for RVs, too, if you like to do that. So if you're interested in coming down, we would love that. So just talk to us. But there's a lot of different needs that we have. We need an AC for the gym, because summer it gets well over 150 degrees in that building. So we need to get an AC to be able to bring people in. Just a lot of stuff that needs to happen. But you know what? We know that God's going to. We know that God has a plan. There's a purpose for us going, and we're going to definitely be able to do it. Today we're looking, you know, for people to be able to commit to us, not just financially, but through prayer, be able to maybe come down during your work team. But you know what? The financial part is important, and we really, really need help in that aspect. It's not cheap being a missionary. We're completely depending on people in the church to be able to support us so that we can go do our ministry. We have a deadline coming up in a few weeks, actually, where we need to have a certain percentage of our support, and we're very close to that. We just need a few hundred dollars more in monthly commitments. So if you're interested, just talk to us, and we can kind of help you out with that. We've got cards in the back where you can give online. You can give, and whether it's a one-time gift or $5 a month, or if you want to do $50 a year, there's so many different ways to give. And it's actually at this point that I really felt like the Spirit was guiding me to read a passage that usually I don't share. Oh, lost my thing. I usually don't share this, but I'm very comfortable with this church just because of who you guys have been in our lives. And I felt like the Spirit was leading me to read James 1, 22 through 27. Do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. Anyone who listens to the word but does not do what it says is like a man who looks at his face in a mirror, and after looking at himself goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. But the man who looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues to do this, not forgetting what he has heard, but doing it, he will be blessed in what he does. If anyone considers himself religious and yet does not keep a tight rein on his tongue, he deceives himself and his religion is worthless. Religion that God our Father accepts as pure and faultless is this: to look after orphans and widows in their distress and to keep oneself from being polluted by the world. That sums up what we do. As not just us, but all Christians. And you know, it's an amazing thing. And this right here, I read this earlier this week and it hit me hard. It was something that really attacked my heart, because you know, I've fallen short in that in so many different ways. And I just wanted to encourage you guys, because I know you guys are faithful. I mean, you're building a new building. That right there takes a lot of financial commitment, and it takes a lot of prayer and dedication. So I know this church is powerful. Okay, the Spirit's here. I felt it this morning. I mean, it's amazing. But we just ask that you continue to pray for us and just to help us out. If you can't do financially, that's okay. We're not looking for, you know, everyone to give. But I do ask that you give to something, whether it's continuing to give your offering here to this church, whether it's to us, someone else. But God calls us to be able to be giving with our money, to be able to giving with our time, and to be able to impact our community for the better because of that. So thank you, guys. Yeah.